give you a welcome. For those of you who don't know, my name's Rodney. I'm Jean's husband. And we're the founder directors of the Gospel Faith Messenger Ministry, which is hosting this conference for these next 2 days. And so we want to give you a really warm welcome here and trust that this will be a very impacting time for all of us. I think we all realise that we could all use a little bit more love for one another. And it reminds me of the joke of the pastor closing his message, and sitting up on the platform was a very grumpy looking elder, you know, and the pastor says, "Well, folks, in closing, I want you to know God loves you, I love you, and Brother Al here is working on it." Yeah, so, but we can all work on it, can't we? So, we have an emphasis over these next 2 days of the love of God. Without love, we are nothing. And so we just really want to look at this and the importance of this in our lives and ministries so that we can be better equipped, better prepared to impact for Jesus. Because really that's what it's at today. And I don't think anybody here will not understand that we are living in a generation that desperately needs God. And God is love. And God wants to touch people's hearts through his love to melt down the resistance, the ignorance, whatever it is that separates people from God. Well, God has chosen ordinary people like you and me to work through. And he wants that meltdown to happen because we are connected with the God of love and are able to convey his heartbeat to the people. And that's a challenge, isn't it? Because some people can climb up your nostril and other places and cause all sorts of concern and so on. And so, we just want to focus on this. For those of you that's not been to one of our conferences before, you will notice that we most likely do things a lot different and that we don't have a big band here to give us all an emotional high to get into things. We are really seeking to just be open to the Holy Spirit, that we can come right into his presence straight away and so on. Now, Kerry will lead us in some worship at some stage during these 2 days. But the thing is that we need to be able to know we can come before the Lord as we are and we can touch heaven simply by being open and available to God. And so that's, you know, that's great. And we want to be encouraging people to be open, to listen to the Holy Spirit, because we'll have an opportunity, especially tomorrow afternoon, for everybody to minister to everybody prophetically. And this is usually one of the highlights of our times together. And we have tapes in that. Everybody will have a tape so that your prophetic words will be recorded and you can take them home with you. And so on. So just be open to the Lord. Let's seek to build friendships, relationships. While we're here together, don't just mix with people that you know, but be open to make new friends and just let love flow between us. Okay? So let's just bow in a word of prayer as we commit this time to the Lord, and that these next 2 days will be very special for every one of us. Father, in Jesus' name, we just come to you right now. We just submit our hearts, our lives, our wills, everything, God, to you. And we say, Holy Spirit, come and teach us how to love one another more. Lord, help us to have a revelation of love. Lord, as you speak to us by your Spirit, you speak to us through your word, as you speak to us through the speakers, that, Lord, that we will, all of us, be in a place where we will receive revelation of God into our hearts and lives, and so leave this place as better people. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that your love has laid hold of us. We thank you we're here because we desire to know you and to love you more. We desire to be better equipped to serve you here on the earth today. And so, Lord Jesus, we just commit ourselves to you and we say, have your way, Lord. Have your way. Help us to be pliable, moldable in your hands so that, Lord, your glory will be seen in a greater way in and through each one of us. In Jesus' name, I pray these things. Amen. 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 Okay, so I'm just going to ask the speakers to come and introduce themselves.
Hello, I'm Kerry. Hands up those who don't know me. You're saved. Good for you. The rest of you can leave whenever you want. I've been with Rodney since about 1998, I think it was, when I met him. And so you can all bear with me as how hard those years have been. And I'll be talking today, sometime, about love teaches, and it quite, won't be quite the way that you think it will be. If you know me, you'll know that that's usually what happens. Good to be here. And what do I do and who am I? Well, I'm married. That's good. My wife is miles away up the hill there and wants to know when I'm going to be talking. And of course, I'm not going to tell her because she'll probably scare me. She'll be at the back heckling me, no doubt. I have three children. I have three children. My son's birthday today. Yes, it's terribly sacrificial at the moment for me. And the other times that I work for myself, doing architecture, and it doesn't make us rich or anything like that. In fact, I haven't had any work for the last 3 months. I always wonder why the Lord does that sometimes, but I think it's all about what we call faith. And in other times, I travel with Rodney overseas, around, and so we mix all that up together, and we leave the rest to the Lord as to what he's going to do with me. And so we just carry on from there. And so that's what I do, and I've enjoyed it all these years. It's good to get out there and meet all different types of people and to do all different types of things. It's good to speak, to have that opportunity. I felt like I have grown over these years, and I have things to share, and especially when we're talking about what we'll talk about in my term in Love Teaches. I have things that I want to speak about, things that I've experienced. I will take some of the worship, and I'm not sure how things are going when it comes to worship, but I will possibly take you into maybe a different type of realm of worship that you've never seldom experienced before. And I'm not actually talking about music, believe it or not. I'm talking about something else. So we'll see how we go with time for that too. So I'll leave it with them, the other guys, to introduce themselves. No, they don't want to. That's all right. Just standing looking glazed look. Come on up.
Thank you. Oh, that was Sakiri, I guess. Well, my name's Richard Johnstone. I've known Rodney, well, you don't really get to know Rodney. I met Rodney many years ago at a youth camp back in the late 80s, and my wife still has this photo of me carrying Rodney, and so I'm here today to help carry Rodney, still, after all these years. I don't know why you asked me, but anyway. I'm married to Deirdre. We have five sons, aged from 16. Yeah, I know I get that reaction when I say five sons. It's usually, oh, you poor wife, or something like that. I have five sons aged from 16 down to 8. I have two jobs. I am part-time minister in a Presbyterian church in Drury in South Auckland, and my other job is running a children's camp out in Clevedon, which is also South Auckland. This is the school holiday, so we're very busy. We have about 50 children in there, so I'm really glad it's a nice, fine day today. And yeah, I'm just, yeah, it's a privilege to be here, and I'm sure we're going to have a great time. What else did you say, Kerry? I was trying to pick up on Kerry's cues to find out what I should say. So, yeah, well, I haven't been anywhere overseas with Rodney. I've been to a couple of churches with Rodney and really enjoyed it. In fact, a few years ago, my last church, I had Rodney come to the church, a little Presbyterian church in Kawakawa Bay, And it just transformed the church, having Rodney there for, well, having God there for the weekend, really. It was, Rodney brought God. And it was such a great weekend. We had people there for the Saturday that they didn't know who Rodney was. And it was, you know, they were a bit suspicious, but they sort of took it on. You can understand that, can't you? Anyway, they accepted that, hey, I knew this guy, and well, you know, if I said it was okay, that'd be okay. So there were people who said, look, I'll be there for the morning, but I've got other things I've got to do in the afternoon. And so we had quite a bit of the church. It was only a small church, and we had quite a bit of the church there for the morning. Well, by lunchtime, they were on their phones, and they were ringing up anybody that wasn't there and saying, you need to be here, and they were cancelling everything they had planned for the afternoon. And so we had about 90% of the church there on that Saturday, and it was just an amazing turnaround in the life of the church. There was one man who wasn't able to be there that weekend, and he came back to church the next Sunday, and at the end of the service he says, wow, what happened in this church? Because this church has changed. And that's the effect that God has when he really, when you let him come into a church. And it did, it transformed that church, and the church is still going really well. It's in a small community, so it's never going to be a mega church or anything like that. But to see what God does in the lives of people when you let the word of God come out and you let people loose on each other with the word of God, I mean, that's the thing. Let people take the chance and make mistakes. And that's what I love about the ministry of GFM, is that we all get the chance to get out there. And I mean, you know, we know sometimes you say things and, well, that didn't quite come out the way I wish it had come out. But that gives us the freedom. God gives us the freedom. Rodney gives us the freedom to say those things. I mean, there's boundaries. There's, you know, where the guidelines are. But we get the chance to really be there doing the work of God and ministering to each other and loving each other. And that's what this weekend's going to be about, loving each other.
Good morning. How many people know who I am? Oh, four, eh? Five? Nobody else knows who I am. That's good, isn't it? That's because I can go home tomorrow or the next day. I'm Peter Riddling. I come from Greymouth, and Rodney's very kindly invited me up to say a few things, and I'm quite pleased about that. I went to Kenya with Rodney last year, and this time last year, actually, and I think it's a bit strange that I'm up here this time, this year. So maybe who knows what's going to happen next year. But tomorrow. Kerry said it was her son's birthday tomorrow. Well, today. It's my birthday tomorrow. It's amazing, isn't it? I'm married to a fantastic lady called Helen, and we have three children, three girls, and they've all grown up and got married. And now we have two grandsons, and a granddaughter and another grandchild on the way. So they live all just around the corner from us and at home, so that's really good. We started the Greymouth Elam Church in 1993, and we've survived that long. And sometimes I wonder how, but we are still there. And being a pastor for 14 years is quite an interesting experience. You learn a lot about yourself, more than anything. And I'll share some of those things later on, maybe. And what else do I do? I pastored for 4 years full-time a number of years ago, and then I thought I was going mental. So I went and got a part-time job with some normal people. that was really saved my life, actually. And I think every pastor in a small church needs to go and find a part-time job and have an outlet of so you can talk to people who are not Christians, and it's a great thing. And so I also come up to help Rodney with his jokes, because he's got hopeless jokes. And so we'll see what happens with that. But I'm really looking forward to the next 2 days, and I might be able to get some sleep tonight after today, so that'll be good. So, yeah, that's all I really want to say at the moment. Rodney, thank you.
Don't ask me where I found them, please. That thought just comes to mind. Some mothers do have them. Yeah. Remember that? But no, it's great. It's great to minister together as teams and to be able to see the impact. Richard doesn't know this, that Peter and I, last month, we just had one meeting in a little Presbyterian church down the South Island in a place called Clinton. I'd never been there before, but it was quite an impacting night. And numbers of the people then travelled to Balclutha. We had a two-day seminar there. And just this week, the Presbyterian minister at Clinton wrote, and they've purchased 16 copies of our School of the Holy Spirit manual, so the whole church can go through seeking the things of the Holy Spirit. So, you know, it's really wonderful to see what God can do with your life when you will listen to what he says and share the things that he says to share. And really that's the key to the prophetic ministry, is simply learning to connect with God. And I think this year it's hit me more than anything else that every great man or woman of God that we read about in the Bible or that you know of throughout history, every one of them were totally unknown nobodies until one thing happened in their life. They heard the voice of God and they obeyed. That was the one thing that turned them around from unknown nobodies to become somebody great for God. That principle has never changed. You see, you can't make an impact by copying someone else's word or ministry. We have to hear it for ourselves. And one of the exciting things about living this way and the life of faith, as we call it, is that nobody, not one person here, knows what God's going to say to us next. Do we? So every time it's a fresh surprise. It's a fresh challenge. And so we have a decision to make every time we hear the voice of God. And God wants us to hear his voice. He wants to speak to us and so on. Okay, we better get cracking in this first session. I really am just wanting to share a bit of my own testimony as to why we have, over the years, placed such a strong emphasis upon the love message, the being motivated by love in Christian ministry. Without love, we are nothing. That's the truth. You know, and it's possible, according to 1 Corinthians 13, to rise to great spiritual heights, knowledge, understanding, faith, prophesying, and still not be loving people. And the Bible says we are nothing. It didn't say we will become nothing. We already are nothing. You see, and so there's a whole lot of ministry that goes on in Christian circles today that really amounts to nothing, because we haven't learned how to love people. And so, you know, my testimony is that I grew up in a pretty sheltered family on a farm down in the Manawatu. Became a Christian at 17 years of age, went on a bit of a backslide for a few months, which I don't recommend. And just at 18, I remember the day, it was a Sunday afternoon, my mother, who was a Christian, came into my room and she just said to me, "I think you should know the old preacher died today," meaning the old guy that I was converted under. And at that point, you see, I said, "Look, I'm not interested, been there, done that. I've tried Christianity, it's not for me, blah, 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 blah." You know, all the excuses that we can muster. And she said, "Well, I just think you ought to know he died today." And with that, she left me alone in my room. And in the next few moments, I got perhaps one of the loudest wake-up calls of my life. Because suddenly I became aware of the fact that whether I liked it or not, somehow I was connected to that man. He was my spiritual father. And when that realization just settled on me, the next thing I became aware of, that for the very first time in my life, that I clearly understood it to be the voice of God right here in the pit of my stomach. It was like I heard these words very clearly: somebody has to take his place. And I knew in a moment of time that that somebody was me. And the power of that word turned my life right around, filled me with a hunger to want to get to know Jesus, and brought me back into Christianity again, and of which I have been pursuing ever since. So then I was taught about water baptism. I was baptized in water. Then I was taught about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And took a while to get there because I had all sorts of problems in my life, like the fear of man, fear of woman, inferiority, insecurity, that most of you know nothing about. Anyway, and finally, God took pity on me and he baptized me in the Holy Spirit in the middle of a herd of cows at 5:30 in the morning. Well, I didn't have the fear of cows, so he got me, didn't he? And then for the second time in my life, I clearly heard the voice of God just come to me. And he said, I'm raising you up to be a preacher of the gospel. And my sign to you that I'm raising you up to be a preacher is that I am going to open doors for you to preach straight away. I was 18 years and 2 months old. And that's exactly what happened. God wonderfully opened the doors for me to start to preach through a miracle of healing of a two-year-old Maori boy with a badly deformed club foot. He was prayed for by Gene's dad, who was the pastor, and instantaneously he was miraculously healed. And the impact of that miracle brought people from miles around to a local marae down at a place called Foxton, and we saw signs, wonders, and miracles. I was thrown in the deep end, began to preach, and I've been preaching ever since. And so my life was going along quite cozy. I was very grateful, and have been to this day, to have been saved into a church that believed in the power of God, that believed in the prophetic ministry, that believed in the voice of God. I know that the prophetic foundation of that church I was saved in was that if we would do what God told us to do, the church would never lack financial provision. And while it was never a rich church, yet whenever some major challenge came up, God miraculously provided finances and we paid cash. And I was involved in two church building programs. We paid cash both times. That was just amazing. And so we were learning the principles, the ways of the Holy Spirit, believing in the power of God, and this was going on okay. And I have been preaching for 16 years. Fairly well established in the ministry of what, you know, God had called me to do at that time, not realizing God was about to forever change my life, my attitude regarding ministry, about people, and so on. How did that happen? Well, again, the voice of God came to me, and he just said this to me: I am going to teach you how to love people. Well, I reacted. I said, excuse me, God, I'm a preacher, you know, big-headed preacher. I said, I do love people. And in the next few moments, very clearly through my mind went the faces of five or six Christians I did not like. And following those faces, the voice of God came through and said, how can a man say that he loves God whom he has not seen if he does not love his own brothers and sisters whom he has seen? From 1st Epistle of John, chapter 4. And then following that through, the Holy Spirit said to me, I want you to know that you can measure your love for me, for God. Your love for me is only as great as your love is for these, the least of my brethren. Well, at that moment, I was just totally empty, totally vulnerable before God. Suddenly I realized that in spite of 16 years, I mean, I was fervent in seeking God. I spent hours in it. I spent hours and hours in the scriptures. I never missed a church meeting. I was Mr. Faithful, Loyal, and True, you know? And after 16 years of that, God says, you only love me as much as those five or six miserable faces that went through my mind. I mean, who were those people? They were people who were criticizing me. They were people who were telling me what I couldn't do and all of that kind of stuff. And I was really starting to react. And I remember one of those guys had been in the church the whole 16 years that I'd been preaching. You know, and I'd never seen him change one bit in 16 years. And I was beginning to think, man, my ministry's no good. It's not changing anybody. You know, you just sit there every Sunday with the joy of the Lord on him. I'm sure he was baptized in lemon juice. And so God saw that concern, that cry, and said, I need to do something about it. The problem's not out there, the problem's in here. He said, I'm going to teach you how to love people. Well, then suddenly I'm in a situation where I don't know how this can happen. I have no idea how to love people. I mean, I'd just been emptied, folks. And I just felt like, man, I really haven't gone anywhere in the last 16 years. But I had, of course. But I was soon to find out that God said, I am going to teach you. Well, I'd be sitting in the church office. This is down in Palmerston North. I'd be sitting in my church office and be a knock on the door, and around the door would come a face of somebody I'd never met before. And it was funny, they'd say, hey, preach, can I talk to you? Well, they were halfway in my office, so I said, come on in, sit down. And these people really began to confess to me all sorts of sins and crimes that I had never heard of. And I'm sitting there listening to these total strangers spilling their intestines to me, and I'm sitting there thinking, why are they telling me? It's not them that needs help, it's me that needs help. You know, because I realized that I had never been able to relate to these kind of people. I, in my sheltered upbringing, you know, if people didn't believe the same way as me, well, then there was something wrong with them. And that's a strong thing amongst Christians today. If you don't come up to my standards, you don't qualify. You know, that's not the love of God. And so these people would be telling me things, and I'd be going home and telling Jesus, man alive, I've heard some things today I didn't think it was possible for human beings to be involved with. And every week it was like God would send somebody worse. And I remember that inside of me screaming out, God, I need your help. I don't know how to help these people. And all the time the Holy Spirit saying, I'm teaching you how to love people. I'm teaching you how to love people. And this went on for a few months, actually. And every week it was like somebody, total stranger, coming in and just sharing all of these things. I tell you, I heard the confessions of rapists, of murderers, of homosexuals, of drug addicts, of witchcraft people. And I tell you, my little sheltered upbringing, all of these people, none of them were in my life before all of this. And suddenly now I'm confronted with people with actual, real, desperate needs. I tell you, I learned something in those days, folks, that even though those people were not Christians, the things that they had done and been involved with were weighing so heavily on the inside that they had to seek out a stranger for help. And they came to me because God wanted to use this season in my life to teach me how to love people. And I still had no idea who they were until one day there's a knock on my office door and in walks the head of the CIB of the police. Big fella. He said, I need to talk to you. I said, sure, what do you need to talk to me about? He said, I want to know what goes on inside of this church. I want to know why people in this area are making a beeline to your church. Well, at that point, I got flushed with pride. You know, I said, what's a church for? He said, yes, but they're not coming on Sundays, are they? He said, I think you ought to know that for the last 3 months, the police have had a 24-hour watch on your church. Because all the most wanted criminals in the Manawatua are making a beeline to your door, and we want to know why. What are they coming to see you for? Well, I didn't know they were the criminals. Wow, he said, what do they talk to you about? I said, that's between them, me and God. He said, fair enough. He said, but we want you to know we think you're doing a good job. And from there, it progressed on until we then got contacted by a person who was part of a satanic coven in this country, which was totally outside of anything that we had experienced before. And from there, you know, God just opened up a world to us that just needed the love of God for us to survive. And at that point, once the underworld, I became dangerous property simply because these people coming to me asking for help and so on were confessing all sorts of stuff. I mean, I got to find out the names of the Mr. Bigs in this country. I got to find out how all the heroin was coming into New Zealand. I got to find out the name of the crooked lawyers around the country that were putting up hundreds of thousands of dollars for the heroin to come into New Zealand. I got to find out the names of doctors that were providing near full-term baby aborted fetuses for satanic ritual communion and so on like that. And suddenly the underworld finds out there's a little preacher on that street corner that knows too much. And so then things began to change and the threats began to come. And it started very subtly with a phone call. Keep your nose out of our business or you are dead. Phone hangs up. And when we didn't pull back, then we start to get the threats. If you value your son, who was 12 at the time, then you better pull back, otherwise we will kidnap him. And by this time we had learned, we used to tell our son, don't you go the same way to school every day and so on like that. And he had was pretty good, he never said too much until about a couple of years ago, was it, Jen? He opened up and started to share with us some of the things that he went through, going to school with a carload of guys banging him on the bike and leering at him, jeering at him, telling him we're going to get you, we're going to get your dad, you know, and this kind of thing. And when you're faced with these situations, folks, you've got to be serious about the decisions you make. It's not just praise the Lord, hallelujah, let's do this. You suddenly are aware of the fact that you could lose very close members of your family. Time, because the pressures were coming on us, the Holy Spirit saying, I'm teaching you how to love people. We began to share some of these things with the Christian community and they couldn't handle the information. And so now we have the underworld against us, we have the Satanists against us, now we've got the Christians against us. And I tell you, at that time, friends, all hell broke loose against our life. And in the midst of it, the Holy Spirit said, I'm teaching you how to love people, I'm teaching you how to love people. Yes, Lord, you know. And but then I had in my heart, I've got to prove to myself that God is bigger than the enemy. If God is not bigger than all of this, then I cannot justifiably preach with any authority that Jesus is the answer to everything. That Jesus is more powerful than the enemy. And so during those times, we experienced the power of God in ways to protect us, because when they saw that we were not pulled back, the next thing we discover is I have 3 death contracts on my life. And, you know, to start with, we just think, well, God, you've got to do something here. We had Christians panicking and telling us, pull back, give it up. Don't get involved in all of this stuff. We had other national Pentecostal leaders telling me I'd lost my mind. I was deceived. I'm telling lies. These things are not true. And so on, to the point I was almost blacklisted from the minister's fraternal. And if you haven't experienced something like that, I can tell you it's not very nice. And all the time, the Holy Spirit saying, I'm teaching you how to love people. Well, for 5 years, these contracts were on our life. And there was all sorts of things happening. We'd be followed in our cars, or turn up at the church office, and there'd be somebody waiting in the car park, and they'd scream off with the tires squealing and all of that sort of stuff. And it was a real time in our lives when we were really in the thick of it. And then in the midst of all of that, Truth newspaper got a hold of what was happening, and we featured in Truth 5 weeks on the trot. I got my photo on the front page. Fortunately, they didn't put me on page 3 with the ladies, and so on. And then Australia picked up, and we had all sorts of people and things happening. And all the time, the Holy Spirit saying, I'm teaching you how to love people. Now, I'm just cutting this all pretty short this morning. But, you know, at the end of 5 years, the head of the Satanic Covens phoned the Assembly of God pastor in our city and confessed over the telephone that Jesus Christ had to be stronger than Satan, because everything they had done to try and destroy us had failed, and they'd never failed before in anything they'd done. And we don't want to go into all of that this morning, folks, but the Satanic Covens are much stronger in this country than you realize. And they control a whole lot of things that go on in this country. And I could tell you some stories about that. Just to say this, that in my time now in the ministry here in New Zealand, I've heard at least a dozen confessions from people who have sacrificed babies to Satan in this country, and these kind of satanic rituals, which is very anti-God, anti-Christ, and so on. Well, at the end of that time, I was in Auckland one day to have a meeting in a place out at Massey, and this stranger walks up to me and he said, excuse me, is your name Rodney Francis? I said, yes. He said, I need to talk to you. I said, okay, what do you want to talk to me about? He said, I was a professional hitman and I was paid $10,000 to shoot you. And he said, I was in Auckland and they gave me a brand new car to drive to Palmerston North to shoot you, and I got to a place called Huntley and this brand new car engine just blew to pieces. So I went back to Auckland, they gave me another car, I got as far as Turangi, and the second car engine blew to pieces. So I phoned them, they said, don't come back here, get a rental car, get down there to do the job. So he got a rental car in Turangi, got to Fielding, and the third car engine blew to pieces. This hitman is freaking out by this point, not knowing what on earth is going on. He said to me, he said, I was so freaked out that I could not get a fourth car to go from Fielding to Palmerston North. So I called the local bikie gang who come and got me and took me to a house just around the corner from where you live. He said, I had 27 guns to sell to the local bikie gangs when I disposed of you. He said, I got to this house, I hadn't been there 30 minutes when the place was surrounded by the cops, and I got caught red-handed with all the guns. So he said, they frog-marched me off to the police station, and they allowed me to make one phone call. He said, I was part of a gang of 4 that we used to do all the dirty work for the Satanists. So he said, I made a phone call to my boss, who was 30 years of age. I told him what had happened, and he dropped dead on the other end of the phone with a heart attack. And he said, I can't explain all these things. My life has just gone all haywire. He said, we hitmen do our preparations and jobs meticulously. There is absolutely no room for mistakes. But for this, he said, couldn't explain it. This was outside of my control. Well, cutting the long story short, he got put in Parima prison for 6.5 years for having these guns. He's up there at that time. GFM ministry is sending Bible lessons into Parima prison, and we had something like 36 inmates doing Bible courses. And they, out of that, they started their own Christian fellowship within the prison. And somebody came and asked this hitman to come to the meeting. Well, he gave them a barrage. He told them in no uncertain terms what he thought of Christians and so on like that, cursing and swearing and so on like that, because he said, all the time I'm sitting in that cell, I'm trying to retract my steps. I was sent on a mission to kill this fellow, Rodney Francis, and everything has gone wrong. And so finally one of the inmates plucked up enough courage, called him an old misery guts, and told him to get to the meeting. It wouldn't do him any harm. So he came, and they had a visiting pastor from one of the churches in Auckland had come in and was speaking to them. At the end of them, he asked them all to close their eyes and put their hands up if they wanted to give their life to Jesus. He said, I didn't want to give my life to Jesus. I'm not interested in this Christian stuff. And he said, my head went down, my hand went up, and the preacher saw it. So the preacher saw his hand and went and sat and talked with him, and as a result of that, actually led this guy to Jesus. He said, the moment I gave my heart to Jesus, I heard this voice. You have been fighting against God and against my servant, Rodney Francis. And when you get out of this place, you have to find that preacher and ask him to forgive you. And here he is, standing right in my face, telling the story. At the end of which, he says to me, sir, would you please forgive me for trying to kill you? I didn't have to pray about that one. And I was able to take that guy into my arms and to love him. And I began to realize that what God had been saying to me, I'm going to teach you how to love people. Something was changing on the inside of me. And from there, I remember I was in another meeting in Auckland, and at the end of preaching, we did the old ritual thing, you know, have an altar call, people come out the front for prayer, and people responded, came out, and here's this well-groomed lady, maybe about 40 years of age. I can still see her. She had her hair black and a bun at the back and meticulously dressed, and I was about to step up to her to do the Pentecostal thing of praying for them, and the Holy Spirit said to me, don't you pray for her. And there's 200 people in the meeting, you know, and suddenly the Holy Spirit stops me and he said, don't you pray for her. I said, excuse me, Lord, we do that, you know, we preach, we have an altar call, people come out. I'm trying to tell the Lord what we do in church, because I'm sure most of the time he doesn't know. And so I was explaining to him what he'd do. And you know what he said to me? He said, she doesn't need your prayers. She needs your love. She's been used, abused, and thrown away. Now you invite her to come into your arms, and I'll set her free. Well, at that moment, I have this big logical conflict, because suddenly I'm not seeing 200 people, I'm seeing 400 eyeballs staring at me. And the devil's sitting on my shoulder going, hey, 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 preacher boy, you're supposed to be praying for the people, not cuddling the ladies. And so you've got this conflict going on. You know, you're standing out the front here like that. What am I going to do? The logical part of me is screaming and saying, don't be so stupid. Well, finally, I just yielded to the Lord, and I stepped up to this lady, and I said, it's okay, sister. The Holy Spirit has told me you've been used, abused, and thrown away. And if you'd like to come into my arms, I'd just love to impart the love of Jesus into you. She burst into tears and fell into my arms. I'm standing there, she's sobbing away because, you know, this was just totally new for me to do something like this in public, where you stood to be criticized, to be misunderstood, and so on like that. I never did pray for that lady, but God instantly, miraculously healed her. And she went home a changed woman. That's funny, because back in those days, you know, we preachers all wore white shirts and stuff, and I had to go home with this white shirt with lipstick all down my shirt and explain to Jesus, to Jean, I've been to church. It's good to have a trusting wife. You see, and so began this journey for me where now people were becoming more important than the sermon. People were becoming more important than me doing things the way that I'd previously been taught. And it became all the more important to me now to listen, because, you see, as I learned to love people more, I found I love God more. As I learned to love people more, I found that I relax more. I found that when you love people, it is much easier to hear the voice of God. When you love people, it is far easier to identify with where they sit. And so my life began to change. In fact, you know, I'm very grateful now after I look back over something like 47 years of ministry that's taken me around the world numbers of times into all different situations, different cultures, and so on. I've had people laugh at me and say, oh, it's all right for you going around hugging people and all of that sort of thing, but you wait till you get in a culture where they don't even have a word for love. They won't understand what you're trying to do. Well, I've been there too, and they may not have a word, but friends, every person responds to love. And I've seen the power of it. I will never forget when we went on our first trip into Germany. And we're in this church in Berlin. And here before us were a group of old ladies in their 70s, some of them in their 80s, who had been multiply raped 12 to 14 times a day by Russian soldiers in the war. And these women, friends, they were zombies. They were walking around, but they hadn't lived for 50 years. The damage that had been done to them emotionally, spiritually, was enormous. And when you stand before somebody like that, you just know. I tell you, quoting scriptures and telling them to pray harder is just so empty, so shallow. They don't need that. Yet how often do we just flippantly throw a scripture at somebody or tell them if they prayed harder, they wouldn't have that problem? You know, some of the most praying saints are persecuted enormously. And so all we could do was we took these ladies into our arms and we just stood there with our arms around them. And I don't think I've ever heard in all of my life such deep-seated, gut-wrenching sobs as these dear old ladies broke and allowed 50 years of humiliation and abuse to be opened up and given over to Jesus. It wasn't about prayers, it was about love. And we were all just crying because of the moment, the power of it all. And I was very blessed to be able to go back less than 2 years later, and those dear ladies that were still alive were just transformed. Totally changed. Because some of us just took a little while to hold them in our arms and just love them. You know, and that in itself is foreign in Germany. They're not an expressive people. If any of you have been there, if any of you have ministered to the people in Germany, the curse of Hitler is still over that nation. Every foreigner that goes into Germany, the name Hitler's not far from the surface of conversation. People need to know the power and love of Jesus. On my last trip into Germany, I was very privileged to spend 3.5 hours with Brother Jun, the heavenly man. And I don't think that I have ever had anybody that just looked straight into my spirit and told me my life. Those of you that have read the book, The Heavenly Man, will know the extreme persecution and suffering that that man went through. And he looked at me and he said, "You think that I have suffered enormously, don't you?" I said, "Yes, you have." And I didn't expect his next comment. This is all through an interpreter. And he just looked at me and he said, "You have suffered as much as I have. It's all been in the area that I'm now experienced, because since he's escaped to the West, the Christians of the West give that man a terrible time." You know, we've got to learn to love people, folks. You're all okay until you start to do something effective for Jesus, and then the Christians try and cut you down. Try and take your legs out from underneath you. They'll criticize you, turn it into a personality attacks, and so on. And I don't know how many times now, as we've traveled around the world, Jean and I spent 3.5 months in a Pentecostal church in Wales a few years ago. And we just stood at the door and we just hugged everybody that came in that door. That was total transformation for that church. They weren't used to that. The official handshake, "God bless you, good morning." And it changed the way that church functioned. It's a big church. It's been a great church. Still is a great church today. Most of the people said, "If you didn't teach us anything else, you taught us how to love one another." Now, friends, the thing is, you can't do that unless you have learned how to love. Now, I don't want to discourage anybody here this morning, but I don't believe that we learn to love by a flick of the finger or a simple prayer. This takes time. God has to change our character. He's got to change the way we think. He has to change the way we function. He has to remove the fear out of our lives so we have the freedom to do what the Holy Spirit asks us. Because what he says for us to minister to one individual may be totally different to any other individual you may be ministering to. Every person is an individual before God. And God knows the key to unlock that person. Now, that love may be expressed with a hug. It may be expressed with words. It may be expressed with a gift. Whatever he says to you to do, do it. He is the Spirit of Truth. He knows the way in to a person's heart and to a person's life. And he wants us, friends, just to listen and to do it. Now, the thing that I have learned perhaps more than anything else is that love liberates us to a freedom to express ourselves that we've never been able to do before. Prior to this experience in my life, if anybody, a woman or a man, especially a man, if they came and wanted to put their arms around me, I would go as stiff as a concrete telephone pole. Oh, he's getting too close, you know. And all of the defense mechanisms went up and I couldn't get out of those arms quick enough. That wasn't their problem, it's my problem. But now I'm happy to wrap my arms around anybody, you know, because what's happened? Those fears, those inhibitions, the self-consciousness, all of those natural things that tend to rob us far more than we're aware of. You know, just think, every time God speaks to us and asks us to do something, why do we hesitate to obey? Because we're afraid of what somebody might say, we're afraid we might get it wrong, or we're scared that somebody might get upset or something. And so all the time we have this conflict. But you know, I have discovered perfect love casts out fear. God is love. And when it comes to Christianity, the whole of our life, our ministry and everything will be judged on the basis on how much do we really love people. We only love God as much as we love other people. Now, I don't know about you, but I tell you what, that challenges us more than any other realm of life. When we have got to open our lives up to other people who often are very, very different to us. You know, I jokingly say now in my travels all around the world, I've had some of the sweetest smelling people and some of the foulest smelling people in my arms. As you see some of these addicts and drunken people that sleep under subways and stuff, to be able to take some of those people into your arms and they cry like babies. They've never known an experience of somebody just accepting them as they are and just loving them anyway. We've got to have a freedom to do that. You know, time's gone, but the biggest rejections I've had of hugging people, funnily enough, have been pastors and their wives. And so I know that, you know, this message can only get through to others after it gets through to us. How much do we love God right now? We love Him as much as we love one another. You know, and a good test for us, friends, the next time you're in your home church, look around, see who you struggle with the most. Don't rush over and say, I struggle with you, I can't stand you. We'll leave that to Kerry. But that will give you an idea of how much you love God. And that means we've all got homework. We've all got to work on it. Son, I'm going to teach you how to love people. You know, here's the interesting question. I don't even know today if I've got the answer for it. But I often ask myself the question, God, why did you have to use the underworld to teach me how to love, and you couldn't use your own church? It's interesting, isn't it? Why do we struggle with one another? We really do need to learn to love one another more, especially people that are very different to us. Try and understand them. Don't reject them. You'd be amazed if you can actually sit down one-on-one and talk with those people and just get them to share a bit of their life with you. often you'll go away feeling ashamed for the way that you thought about them because you haven't understood the crosses they've had to carry, the battles, the rejection, no love from mum or dad, and it's had this huge influence upon their lives. Without love, the Bible says, we are nothing. Absolutely nothing. It's not about friends, what you know. It's about who you know. It's knowing the God of love who's given us a command that we should love one another. By this, he said, all men will know that you are my disciples because of your love one for the other. John 13, 34, 35. That's the mark of a Christian, by how much we love one another, not by what we know, not about our teachings, not about our services, not about our worship, not about a whole lot of things that we count important in Christianity today, but it's about how much we love one another. And you know as well as I do, and I finish with this, finally, brethren, for the 34th time, you and I know that in Christianity, even in our fellowships, there are some people who are actually quite nice. Then there are other people that are... you're not sure which planet they really arrive from. And then there are other people that you feel strongly impressed to pray that God would lead them to another church. So why does God do that? Because he wants to teach us how to love people. Avoid cliques. Avoid just associating with people that you get on well with all the time. Stretch your borders. Challenge yourself. And seek to get to know people that maybe up to this point in time you've found difficult. Get behind the walls and let the love of Jesus flow. Amen? Well, here ends the first lesson. So what have you got there?